Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. As you can see from my script, I'm both narrator and prompt, which is why I'm here on time. My role is to help you to follow the story, to help the cast to follow the story, and above all, to follow the story myself, because if I get lost, we're all doomed, Mr. Mannering. A couple of points before we start. You, the audience, have as much of a part to play as the cast. There are three Asians you need to be aware of. No, madam, not Asians, Asians. A-T-I-O-N-S. The first is anticipation. You all know the story of Snow White, so be ready as things happen to react as it goes along. The second Asian is participation. We'd like you to boo and hiss. Now, clearly, in these COVID-ridden circumstances, you may be uncomfortable about doing that. But if when the boo comes along, if you just like to do that and shake your fists, that's quite enough, although the odd one or two of you booing will be very much appreciated by the cast. We do need you to take part in the odd banter, you know, oh yes it is, oh no it is, that sort of thing. The important thing to remember is the cast are all making fools of themselves, and we'd like you to do the same. The final one is imagination. Characters in the play are meant to be young. A tender young princess, her dashing young suitor, and the dwarves, all young men, or in our case, men and women. Given the average age of our cast is over 70, that access to scenery and props is severely limited, and we're all very much amateurs. You will understand that is this Asian imagination that is the most important. Ah, I'm sorry, somebody's just asked me, one of the cast, who just said, why is he wearing that silly suit? Well, of course, you all know that pantomimes are tales of old, and these are my tales of old. Ooh, but that's a good one, thank you. But enough, let's get on with the show. Kind friends, I pray you give me time to introduce our pantomime. It's very short, and what is worse, it's written in atrocious verse. I hope the acting's not the same, or else you wish you never came. You've read, of course, in storybooks about the girl whose beauteous looks and persil-washed complexion bright have earned for her the name Snow White. These storybooks you must not heed. They are not truthful, no indeed. Such tales a thinking, no thinking person swallows. The real story is as follows. Act One, a palace, long ago. The curtain rises now to show Gustav, the royal wizard's mate.
Oh, Flip, I hope the bus ain't late. I don't know how to work the doings.
This lad will have the place in ruins. What is this strange contraption, Sirrah?
Oh, it's supposed to be a magic mirror.
Ah, yes, good friends, you've heard about this magic glass, I have no doubt. And presently, the Queen consults it every day. And presently, you'll hear her say,
"Mirror, mirror, on the wall, who is there to saw us all?"
Well, that wasn't bad, but I would have expected better. Come on. Anticipation, you all knew it was coming. And participation. I'll give you the line again. And presently you'll hear her say,
"Mirror, mirror on the wall, who's there to saw us all?"
Thank you. flies the looking glass, your majesty doth all surpass. This interesting little custom we'll now observe.
I think I'll bust him.
What are you doing?
I don't know. I can't get the thing to go.
But here comes real cause for worry. It's Jamie the wizard, in a hurry.
Come, switch it on and help me in it. We'll have the Queen here ready for it.
Good sir, your bold assistant here has got into a mess, I fear.
Oh no, I told him how to work it.
5 valves gone in 1 short circuit.
You surely can't have broken 5. Look, just get out. Let me sort.
Look out!
I don't have to do this.
I think that wire's alive.
Oh, and all the stupid blundering dolts! You fill my fingers full of faults! Oh! Oh! Oh!
While JB goes to seek first aid, in comes Snow White, the laundry maid. Our Gustav rises to his feet. He feels his heart begin to beat.
Whatever's bitten poor JB?
He's not very pleased with me.
And that is quite, I sadly fear, the understatement of the year. The maid advances to the table, where Gustav shows the offending cable. Her nimble fingers deftly fix the wire inside the box of tricks. And now she straightens up to say,
I think you'll find that's quite okay.
As Gustav gazes at her proudly, his heart is beating very loudly. Bowing in a manner dashing, he says,
Corflip, I think you're smashing.
A compliment I would have said that might be misinterpreted. But Gustav's heart has ceased to beat, for he has heard the sound of feet approaching with a regal tread.
The Queen!
All right, don't lose your head.
So saying, this resourceful dame shoves Gustav in the picture frame and giving him a loving look, she starts to check the laundry book.
Make way and bow the knee before her gracious majesty.
Queen Vanity, the Queen of Beauty.
All right, I thank you both. You've done your duty.
Be silent all before the Queen.
All right.
And let no frown be seen.
All right.
Make way. Make way.
Her Majesty with joy shall fill you.
Make way, make way.
Oh, shut up, will you?
The questioning's about to start. Let's hope that Gustav's learned his part. With carriage proud and step serene, towards the mirror moves the Queen.
Mirror, mirror, on the wall, who is the fairest of them all?
Instead of JB's prompt reply, the mirror seems to give a sigh. As Gustav bites his bottom lip and softly murmurs,
"Calf lip!"
Softly murmurs. Impatiently, the Queen once more repeats the question as before.
"Mirror, mirror, on the wall, who is the fairest of them all?"
"Your Majesty doth all surpass."
"Your Majesty is as bold as brass."
"No, no, I never told you that."
"Oh, I mean, you're old and very fat."
"What's this?"
"Do get the answer right."
"The fairest of them all is Snow White."
"Hooray!"
"I thought so."
"So, ho, my magic mirror rare, you think my laundry maid is fair? This day for her shall be her last. Seize yonder maid and hold her fast. In darkest forest, set her free. About the time the lions have tea, I think you'll find that by tonight, only her bones will be Snow White."
Exit the Queen with horrid laughter. Snow White is quickly hustled after, as Gustav cries in sore distress.
"What a flipping mess!"
Far off they take the hapless maid and dump her in a forest glade, where hungry creatures have their lairs, and lead her to the lions and bears. But near that spot, among the trees, a funny little house she sees. A funny little house she sees!
"Only got one pair of hands."
"Oh." "With seven chimneys in a row, and seven little windows low, and seven little rooms inside, for there the seven dwarfs reside. And here they are, their day's work done."
"I'm home!"
"Arriving home at setting sun." The tallest only 2 feet 10. But so as not to hurt your eyes, we've magnified them double size. Good evening to you, little elves.
Good evening.
Evening.
Perhaps you'll introduce yourselves.
7 little dwarfs are we.
Nicer dwarfs you'll never see.
Our names are Wednesday.
Tuesday.
Monday.
Thursday.
Friday.
Saturday.
Sunday.
Delightful names. They suit you well. But how you got them, who can tell?
The truth is not so hard to see. You see, we're just a little weak.
The magistrate, to coin a phrase, told Dad he'd give him 7 days.
Dad says
Our names remind him still of holidays in Pentonville.
So now our story we've repeated.
I thank you, dwarves. Do please be seated.
Why are you sitting there?
Ah, good. That's better. Now let's hear how things are going.
Bad, I fear.
Our tyres are flat and our bikes are rusted.
The lights are fused and the TV's busted.
The copper kettle's sprung a leak.
The mangle's got an awful squeak.
The paper's peeling off the walls. The wallpaper.
See, there's a death watch beetle in the ceiling.
The awful truth we have to face. We need a man about the place.
Right, now we've said our little piece, it's time to go and feed the geese.
Oh, and wrap some leather around our legs.
And search the nettle patch for eggs.
Each take a stick and if attacked, you all know how you ought to act.
Yes, I think we
So now the dwarves, their weapons take. It seems an awful fuss to make. It really looks a bit absurd to go out armed against a bird.
Now listen here, mate, don't you chide us. Remember, you have magnified us. The gander is twice as big as me, and I am only 2'3".
Of course, I'd quite forgotten that. Well, do be careful what you're at. So off they go, with courage rash, to give the geese their daily mash. But hardly have they left before a knock sounds at the other door. And seeking shelter for the night, appears our heroine, Snow White. She scarcely can believe her eyes, and looks around in great surprise.
This place is in a shocking state. I'll have to try and put it straight.
Then, in a most efficient manner, she fetches out her pocket spanner. Pliers, screwdriver, oil can, to make the place look spick and span. In less time than it takes to tell, the TV set is working well. The mangle's had a lovely oil. The mended copper kettle's boiling. The house is clean from floor to thatch. Even the Death Watch Beetles met his match. While seven bikes with tyres inflated stand gleaming as if silver-plated. I trust that your imagination can cope with such a situation. Yes, it can! It can, come on. Exhausted now, the maiden goes upstairs to seek well-earned repose and rest her weary feet and legs. Re-enter dwarves with goose's eggs. They gaze around in consternation at such a wondrous transformation. Really? and blink at all the shining metal on mangle, bikes and copper kettle.
Whoever could have been in here?
It's more than one, that's very clear.
Perhaps they sent the army, eh?
Or perhaps the local U3A. No mortals work at such a pace. They must have come from outer space.
The place has never looked so clean.
And Strictly is now upon the screen.
Awakened by the noisy din, Snow White now quickly hurries in.
Now then, you naughty little boys, stop making all that dreadful noise.
At first, this makes the dwarves defiant.
We're not afraid of you, you giant.
Then, noticing her belt of tools, the leader cries.
What silly fools we are to get in such a panic. This is our unknown mechanic.
Oh. Snow White admits that this is true.
I'd like to stay and work for you.
Yes.
The dwarfs all try to make amends, and soon they are the best of friends. They turn the music on once more, and all together take the floor. So thus Snow White the office took, a foster mother, housewife, cook, of electrician, engineer, and time went on for half a year. Meanwhile, within the palace grey, poor Gustav nearly pined away. But now the queen begins to hear reports that fill her heart with fear. Within the forest, so 'tis said, there dwells a maid who's far from dead. Every day her beauty grows. The jealous queen with anger glows. Proceeding to disguise herself, she takes an apple from the shelf, scoops out the fruit, and puts inside... Ooh, what's the rhyme for that? Potassium of cyanide. So, as the curtain once more rises, prepare yourselves for more surprises.
So Sleeping Beauty came to life and soon became the prince's wife. The palace rang with joy and laughter and all lived happily ever after.
Oh,
don't stop. Yeah, we'll all be good.
Yeah. Read about Red Riding Hood.
Goldilocks. Who met the bears?
No, it's time to go upstairs.
Come on. I don't want to go to bed. I want to go to bed. They're all younger than me. They ought to go first.
Good night, then, Wednesday, Tuesday, Monday, Thursday, Friday, Saturday and Sunday.
So off they go. And Snow White, yawning, goes off as well to sleep till morning. But who is this, so darkly gliding, beneath her cloak an apple hiding? Yes, I'm sure you recognised the bad queen, Vanity, disguised.
Snow White shall die. So be it. I'll leave this apple where she'll see it. One bite from this, however small, and I'll be the fairest of them all. And you with the grey hair, I'll have you too.
But little has the Queen divined that someone else is close behind. And hardly has she left the place when round the corner comes the face of faithful Gustav. All suspicious, he sees the apple, so delicious, lifts the poison to his nose, inhales the fumes, and down he goes. The noise he makes is so distressing that down the stairs the dwarfs come pressing. They gaze in horror at the sight, and one runs off to fetch Snow White.
Another giant, dead, I fear. I wish he hadn't died in here.
Such a size, we'll never lift it. We'll have to cut him up to shift him.
I'll get a knife. I'll get a spade.
I'll go and get a coffin made.
I'm not sure whether he's church or chapel.
But Snow White enters, takes the apple. Throws it away. And with a sigh, our Gustav opens half an eye. Then opens both.
Here's the knife. Too late. I think he's come to life.
Tell him you've come to life, dear Gustav.
Cut off, Flip. I think I must have.
With that, he takes his lady's hand. The tactful dwarfs all understand.
When you wish upon a star, makes no difference who you are. Anything your heart desires will come to you.
When through the window, suddenly, appears the wizard, old JB. He carries in his hand two scrolls.
There, has he got the scrolls?
No, he always rolls like that.
Which now he carefully unrolls.
Arsenal 0, Tottenham Hotspur 7.
Come on, you Spurs! Come on, you Spurs!
This parchment proves that you, Gustav, are king of Timbuktu. While Snow White here is nothing less than Lady Blanche, the Crown Princess.
Smooth. And hands.
My child, forgive your foolish aunt. I tried to kill you, but I can't.
Oh, yes, I can.
No, no, you can't.
I have a few of you as well. Please,
my crown.
Here, take my crown. Hurry up, hurry up. I've had it sprayed. And I will be your laundry maid.
This is, as you can see, entirely satisfactory. Snow White and Gustav now can wed and occupy the throne instead. So that's the real tale, my friends. And there, I fear, our story ends.
I say, I hate to make a fuss, but haven't you forgotten us?
Ah, yes, the dwarves. I beg your pardon. In every small suburban garden, your figures shall forever be found standing round the rockery. So finishes my humble task. To give the final word, I'll ask King Gustav and her ladyship.
I'll say farewell.
And I'll say,
call Rick!
Thank you to the two Jeffs, Jeff Farney down here and Jeff Bailey at the back. Jeff Farney for his wonderful sound effects, as ever, they're wonderful, thank you. And Jeff Bailey at the back, who's been recording throughout our rehearsals and today and dress rehearsals. So early in the new year, we will have a put together version. And we'll probably, it'll certainly be on YouTube and available for you all to look at. And hopefully we'll show it at a coffee morning as well. I'd also like to say thank you to Richard for stage management. He's the one who's had to rush backwards and forwards to make sure things all work. Ably supported here by Margaret. Thank you, Margaret.
Costumes.
I'm just doing that bit, Val. I got the script.
That's right.
Margaret also did some costumes. Where did the flowers go?
There.
Oh, they're there. I need them now, please. Thank you. Yeah, there's two lots in there. Yes. We don't buy flowers for the men, but here's flowers for Margaret to say thank you for your part of state building, but also for costume. And a special thank you for Val, who has the title. She has the title of director and producer, but she's also been agony aunt and bully at times. She's had a dreadful job. A, because our age is such that over the course of the production, various members of the cast have dropped out and had to be new ones found. She's been so patient, so kind to all of us, given us all excellent advice, and as you can see, the result's been fantastic. So thank you, Val.
Now, John.
You are. I did notice. I wasn't going to say, but I nearly forgot. And Phil was standing out in the cold, guarding the car park to make sure there's enough room for you all for the second performance. So thank you, Phil. Thank you all very much indeed for coming. Those of you who are more able amongst you, if you could stack the chairs in eights, we would really appreciate it. But thank you all very much indeed.
Thank you. Thank you.